My father was, I think he was 38. He got a call from his mother, who was in the hospital. She had diabetes, and they told him they didn't think she would live past the week. And so he went to the hospital. He stayed by her side. She actually came out of the hospital, lived for another 10 years. He came out of the hospital with really high blood glucose, and it came on really suddenly for him, and he went to the doctor right away and was diagnosed as diabetic. When my father was diagnosed with diabetes, I was 14 years old, and I think I told him that I was going to find a cure for him. And so it was pretty influential. It did give my life purpose, and it influenced the direction I took. My laboratory has tried to look for common mechanisms that might be relevant across the different diabetes subtypes that could contribute not only to diabetes and glucose control, but also to its complications. And a little over 20 years ago, we stumbled on this molecule called ceramide that we think is particularly damaging to cells, and it seems to influence how glucose is used, and also how insulin, the hormone that regulates glucose, is secreted. But also it influences a lot of other cell types in the body too. And so we've seen over the years that there's a real therapeutic opportunity by preventing accumulation of these damaging ceramide molecules. We think we could have a big impact on a lot of different diseases. We've spent a lot of time trying to figure out ways that we could lower ceramides safely and mainly using mice and rats. We just got rid of a little double bond in ceramides, and that seems to be sufficient to inactivate them. And this mouse remarkably doesn't get diabetes, it doesn't get heart disease, and it doesn't get kidney disease. So this is pretty remarkable. So this is like a super mouse. And so we've partnered with a group out of San Francisco to try and make some drugs to mimic that effect, to try and make that same modification to ceramide molecules. And the drugs also seem to be doing the same thing. I'm excited about where we are. We hope to be in clinical trial in the next year. I think we really are on the verge of having a clinical intervention to help a lot of people. I love the research we're doing in the lab, and it's incredibly satisfying and fun, but there were other ways I wanted to give back, and the idea of building a community of researchers around this link between metabolism disease or metabolic health was really appealing to me. One of the things we've done here at Utah is we've broken down silos, so whether somebody's working on diabetes or heart disease or cancer or kidney disease, we've been able to come together, bring common technologies, common research models, and things. So we've brought people together in a way that has informed discovery. And I don't think other universities are doing this in quite the same way. The discoveries that are coming out every day around how metabolism influences disease is really impressive. And I just can't think of a better place to be doing this kind of research. But in addition to that, it's the people. We have this collaborative group of intellectually enlightened investigators that love to work together and love to ask hard questions and think outside the box and really inform what we're doing every day. I don't think I could have made the kind of progress we've made anywhere else in the world. Well, I promised at the age of 14 that I was going to cure my father's diabetes, and I haven't done that. So, but we keep trying, we keep fighting the fight and trying to take the next step. I don't know if we're going to be able to do anything that's going to influence my father's health. He's 84 years old. But I do hope that someday the research that we're doing, if it won't help him, it'll help his grandchildren or his great-grandchildren. I say all the time that, I've failed, that I'm a failure because I've not cured my dad's diabetes. I don't think he thinks of me that way. No. I think he's proud.